can make it, do it, makes us all the better, faster, stronger. That
don't kill me, can only make me stronger. I need you to hurry up, man, cause I can't wait much longer. I know I got to be right now, cause I can't get much stronger. Man, I've been waiting all night, man, that's how long I've been on ya.
Well, greetings, family. It is an honor. Listen, it is my prayer today as we get ready for the word, that this word charge us. God, let it challenge us. But more importantly, God, let this word change us. It's in your son, Jesus the Christ's name, we pray. Amen. Come on, grab your copy of the word of the Lord and let's get into this word. 2 Kings chapter 7. I'm not going to read it all, but we're going to look at all the verses. Verse number 8 through 20. 2 Kings chapter 7, verse 8 through 20. Come on, I want you to get this. And when you get it, say, I am with you. I'm with you. 2 Kings chapter 7, verse number 8 through 20. Now, remember now, we're not going to read all of it, but I definitely want to look at these verses because there's so much information in there that's going to help us as we get into this lesson. Listen at what it said. I want to read at verse number 9. Look at what verse number 9 says. Now, verse number 9 says, then they said to one another, we are not doing right. This day is a good day of good news. If we are silent, listen at this, and wait until morning, like punishment will overtake us. Now, therefore, come, let us go over to the king's household. Now, I'm getting ready to get into this lesson, but let me say this, because remember now, it was the king that kicked them out of the city. The king kicked them out. And these lepers in this particular story found abundance. They found money, resources, and they said, we're not doing right. Let's go and tell the king's house. The man that kicked us out, let's go tell him. I want to talk for a few moments with this thought in our mind. Can you handle being blessed? Come on, I need you to type it there. It's going to be on the screen for you. Can you handle being blessed? There was a story told some years ago about a pastor who loved to take lavish vacations in the middle of nowhere. And he went on a lavish vacation in the jungle of South Africa, somewhere between Costa Rica and the Panama. And it was a remote, secluded island, a resort island. And after flying, listen at this, for 22 hours, he then had to take a taxi ride from the airport, which took another 4 hours to his destination. After driving almost 2 hours, he got frustrated and he asked the driver, how much longer? To which the driver replied, sit back and relax. We have another 2 hours to go. After getting there, he found another couple that was from the United States. And he asked this couple while they were getting something to eat by the pool, were you all frustrated at all with the drive from the airport here? And to which the couple replied, wait a minute, how long did it take you? And he says, 4 hours in a taxi. And they looked at one another with dismay on their face. And the man, the husband rather, said to him, sir, did they not tell you that you could charter a flight that would only take 45 minutes? Now, at this point, the pastor, the preacher, was upset because he was already thinking about the drive back after the vacation. Can I say this? He only took the 4-hour taxi ride because he did not know he had other options available. And that's what the enemy wants to do to us. He wants us to feel like we are out of options. And when we're out of options, we don't have power and authority over the decisions that we have to make. He wants us in a place where we have to deal or play with the hand that life has dealt us. That's where the enemy wants us. But I say this because Proverbs 18:21 says that the power of life and death is in our tongue. And if we speak life, we'll have life. So whatever we speak out of our mouth, that's what shall be established. Listen at this. If I'm speaking what God already spoke, I can't speak my own truth. I have to speak what he's already spoken. So I want to give you a moment for the next 20 seconds to speak some things out of your life, out of your mouth, over your life. Come on, for the next 20 seconds, you can type it there, but go ahead and speak some things. I'm blessed when I come. I'm blessed when I go. My kids are blessed. My future grandkids are blessed. My home is blessed. Come on, I need you speaking some things. Don't just write it, speak it. I want you to type it in the comments. Everything I touch is blessed. My children are blessed. They may not be here now, but they're blessed wherever they are. My grands, my great grands, I need you to speak some things because life and death is in our mouth. Come on, write this down. It'll be on the screen. Your kingdom nugget for today, which is the premise for the lesson, is this: an open mouth opens options. Okay, can I say that again? An open mouth opens options. Y'all know the saying, a closed mouth don't get fed. I knew you knew it. I knew it. So an open mouth opens options. And that's what these lepers did. They acted in a way that they spoke. To think about this, they were not only vocal about what they wanted to do, they became active concerning their faith. God was moving not where they were, but God was moving where they were going. He had already made a way for them, but they had to get up and go to see the way that was already made. When you study this text, you understand that God spoke to them, the Bible says, at twilight. At twilight, God spoke to them at twilight and said, arise, go over into the enemy's camp and you're going to find the gold, the silver, cattle, everything. They've left it all. And when you keep reading in that text, you discover that the word says that the people, the enemy, arose at twilight. So God spoke to them at twilight and the enemy left at twilight. But they would have never known that the enemy left had not they got up and acted on their faith. So at twilight, God had the enemies to leave, but he spoke to his children, his people, the lepers, to go and get what was left for them. Did y'all hear that? It was at twilight that the enemies left, and at twilight, the lepers went, got the word to go into the city. So principle number one, write this down. You will see extreme abundance when you take God at his word. I'm talking about 2021. I'm not talking about next year. I'm talking about this year. When you and I take God at his word and operate in bold faith, we're going to see extreme abundance. Why do you say that, Pastor? Look at the text. Verse number 8, they went looking for food. There was a famine in the land. They had been put out of the city and they had no food. So they went looking for food. But when they got there, look at what they found. The Bible says they found food. They found clothes and they found jewelry, among other things. So they didn't just find what they were looking for. God gave them something extra. Look at verse number 11. They found transportation, jewelry, and shelter. They found what they didn't ask for because they moved on faith. I need you to hear this. They didn't even ask for shelter. They didn't even ask for clothes. They didn't even ask for transportation. But when they got there, they found what they didn't even ask for. Can I talk to somebody? You're going to experience some things this year that you didn't even ask for. You're going to knock on doors that you didn't even ask for. You're going to walk into places you didn't even dream about because you're going to operate in bold faith. Somebody type in there, bold faith, bold faith, bold faith. Come on, principle number two, write it down. In 2021, you will not just experience a sufficient supply, but you will also experience abandoned abundance. Oh my goodness, I need you to get this. You're not going to just experience sufficient supply, just enough. But God says, because you act in faith and obedience, you're going to experience abandoned abundance. What is that, Pastor Ren? God is going to bless you in a way that is suitable, sufficient, and supernatural. I need somebody to get this. Did you hear what I said? Somebody type it in there if you believe it. Everybody may not believe it, but I need you to type it if you believe it. I received that, Pastor. God is going to bless me this year in a way that's suitable, that's sufficient, and that's supernatural. I need God to bless me with something eyes haven't seen, ears haven't heard. Come on, this year he's going to give me something that's suitable, that's sufficient, and that's supernatural. Look at the text. Look at the text. The king doesn't even know anything about this. There were no armies coming after them. It was just the wind that blew. Look at it. Look at it in verse number 6. It was the wind that blew. And the Lord shouted, listen at this, when the wind came, they thought that they were being ambushed. They thought enemies, armies had gathered together to come against them. They heard a strong wind and they got up in haste and ran and left everything. See, listen at this. Before we can walk in greatness, we must experience the greatness of God. See, oftentimes we're saying, God, I want you to do this, but God is saying, I want you to experience me first. Did you not know it takes a great God to make a wind blow that strong that caused the enemy to think armies have gathered together against them? It had to have been a great God to cause a wind to blow for them to get up and leave everything that they had, thinking that people were coming after them. See, it was abandoned abundance, things that other people left that they didn't appreciate. Can I tell somebody? There's somebody right now in a cubicle that's taking advantage of it that don't appreciate it. God is going to allow them to walk off and leave it. You're going to walk right into something they didn't appreciate. There is a man out there that somebody didn't appreciate that did the best he could to take care of his family, take care of the house, that somebody took for granted and gonna walk off and leave them. God says you're gonna walk right into something that they didn't appreciate. Same thing with the woman that a man took advantage of. He didn't appreciate the gift that God gave him. He used and abused them. It doesn't have to be physical, it could be verbal. But God says, if you remain faithful to me, you're going to walk in a abandon abundance. You're going to find something that's suitable, someone that's sufficient, and somebody that's supernatural. Oh my God, help me talk in here. Somebody is messing over a good job because they don't appreciate the greatness of God. But God is going to give you a shot at it because your heart is pure and you're ready to see the greatness of God. Somebody fumbled favor away that you're going to pick up and run with because you appreciate God. Did you hear that? Can I say it again? Somebody fumbled favor away. But you're going to appreciate it when you pick it up because you understand it's not what I have. It's about having God. Come on, look at verse number nine. Then they said to one another. they think about it. Now, let's set up the text now. They walk into this place and they find all the gold, the silver, the cattle tied up. They find Gucci. They find Prada. They found some Jordan 1s. Yeah. They found all of this abandoned abundance. And here is what they say. We are not doing right. Lepers that were kicked out of the city by the king, they looked at each other and with all this jewelry, all this gold, and said, we're not doing right. If we are silent till the morning, something's going to happen to us. We must go and tell the king. Now, this messed me up because the king is the one that put them out. See, this is why I asked the question, can you handle being blessed? Come on, let's talk. Think about it, ladies. Can you handle helping the man that would not help you with your child, but you see him on social media booed up with somebody and they three kids? Can you pray for him? Can you encourage the supervisor that set up a situation to get you fired so they can get their friends or family or loved ones in that position? Can you pray for them when you find out that they're not doing well? Oh, my goodness, I'm talking good now. I'm talking good. Can you pray for the man that dogged you out or the woman that cheated on you when you did nothing wrong? You tried to be the best man you can be. She didn't appreciate you, but now she got somebody that ain't worth a nickel and she all on social media talking about, well, look at us. We at sticks again. My babe doing it up for me. Can you pray for them? Lord have mercy. Look at the text. Look at the text. Come on, I need you to get this. Principle number three. Here it is. Write it down. Screenshot it. If you're going to be great, you have to learn how to manage blessings. Did y'all hear me in the back? If you're going to be great, you're going to have to learn how to manage blessings. Look at verse number nine. God wants you to tell others about what he's done for you. I'm talking to somebody now. Don't you hide your blessing another day. But Pastor, God gave me this business idea and things are booming, but I don't want people to think I'm bragging. It's okay. Let them think what they want. You know you trust God and that you're humble and you operate in humility. Don't you water down the blessings and the favor of God that's on your life for nobody. Either they need to come up or you'll get you some new people that appreciate you, but don't you hide it another day. Manage the blessings, but understand God wants you to tell somebody, because here it is, when you tell others of the goodness of God, it increases their faith to believe that if God could do it for you, he can do it for me. I know what you used to do every Friday and Saturday night. And if God can send you a king, my goodness, I know he can send me one. I know what you used to do during the week. And if God can send you a queen, I know he can send me one. Come on, come on. Listen to this, y'all. God wants you to tell your testimony. Look at what they say. If we wait and tell it, punishment is going to come over us. When we know other people are suffering and God has given us the answer for them, but we don't help them, shame on us. I'm going to say it again. Shame on America when we know people are out there hungry and we don't help them. Shame on Alabama when we know people are hurting and hungry and we don't help them. Shame on the church when we know people are hurting and we don't help them. We must help the homeless, help the least, the last, the lost, and the left out. It's our responsibility. Ah, God, we got to help, we got to help, we got to help. Don't forget, you had always been able to look as good as you look. You had always been able to drive what you're driving. God, I'm talking to somebody. You had always been able to live where you're living. Don't forget. Look at the text. Look at the text. Look at the text. Look at the text. The lepers. What are lepers, Pastor? They were criticized. That they were ostracized. They were people that could not, or you couldn't sit on a seat that a leper sat in when they got up. They were devalued because of a skin disease. They had to yell unclean, unclean, whenever they came into contact with other people. They had to yell unclean, unclean, unclean. They had issues that people could see with their natural eye, but they may have been good on the inside. Have you ever been there where you had a good heart, but you had some physical ailments or you had some things on the outside that people could see? And they gave more credit to what they knew about you than what was on the inside of you. Look at this. Lepers, they were lost, left out, but they found abandoned abundance and they wanted to help somebody else. Can I give you your kingdom shout? Write it down, screenshot it. Don't let life make you bitter, let life make you better. I need you to get this, y'all. Don't you let life make you bitter because they dogged you out. Don't you let that make you bitter. Just because they took advantage of you, don't you let that make you bitter. Let it make you better instead of bitter. They didn't allow themselves to become bitter because of the way other people treated them. They allowed what they went through to make them better. They were better, not bitter. See, most people don't know how to be happy because we're so busy being bitter. All men are dogs, Pastor. You hadn't dated all men. It was just a few. All women are low down and they skeezers, whatever the word is. Listen, all women ain't skanks. You just dated the wrong ones. All jobs don't want to take advantage of you. You just was employed with the wrong ones. We've got to be better and not bitter. You've been divorced 5 years. Why are you still bitter at him? Why are you still bitter at her? Listen at this, y'all. That church hurt happened 20 years ago. Why are you still bitter at God because of what some man or woman did? You've got to allow those experiences to make you better, not bitter. God help me talk. You must be grateful enough to be relational. Be friendly to somebody in spite of what other people did. See, look at the text. Look at the text. I need you to get it. I don't want you to think I'm making it up. Look at the text. Verse number 9 says they wanted to tell the king's house, but it was the king that put them out. They wanted to tell the king's house, but it was the king that kicked them out the city. What are you saying, Pastor Ren? The king left them out to die. Look at verse number 3. They were at the entrance gate. This was the play that the lost place that was enacted there. Judgment was there from the king, and he said they should have died there. Can you bless the people? Lord have mercy. I'm talking to you now. Can you bless the people that tried to hurt you? Can you pray for the people that didn't pray for you? Can you give the people a ride that didn't give you a ride when you were standing at the bus? Yeah. See, the real measure of your Christianity is, can you help those that didn't help you when you were in the same position as them? Ooh, God, I'm talking good. I'm talking good today. See, maturity is when God wants me to bless the person that didn't bless me when they were in my position. God will use your embarrassment to make it become your empowerment so that your misery will become the platform for your ministry. Did you hear what I just said? Let me say it again because I think you missed it. God will use your embarrassment and make it your empowerment so that your misery become the platform for your ministry. If you allow life to make you better and not bitter, don't let it make you bitter. God wants to use the pain of your life to birth your purpose. He wants to use the pain of your past to birth your purpose. There's something in your past that will give you passion to do something even greater. Did you hear what I said? There's something in your past that will give you the passion to do something greater. Look at the text. At the beginning of chapter 7, the prophet speaks prophetically about the city because the prices were ridiculous. The prophet told the brothers, it's going to happen. It's going to happen. And because you don't believe it, you won't eat none of it. In other words, God is about to put food on sale. But because you don't believe it, look at it in chapter 7, because you don't believe it, it won't happen. So this is what happened as a result of the lepers telling their testimony. In verse number 16, the word of the Lord came to pass as a result of the lepers sharing what they found. This is what happened, y'all. Their embarrassment became their empowerment. Their condition led them to look for food, which ultimately saved the entire city. God used four people that were kicked out of the city to save the entire city. And I'm telling somebody, God is going to use you not just to save you, but to save your house. He's going to use you to save your block. He's going to use you to save your neighborhood. What do you mean, Pastor Wren? As long as I remain faithful and humble to God, he's going to use me to bless everybody connected to me. Oh, God, this is what blessed me. Look at this, y'all. This is what blessed me. It's not a principle, but it should have been. This is what blessed me, because oftentimes we think when things change, we change. Write this down. Here it is. The promise of God changing things does not guarantee everything will change. The promise of God changing things does not guarantee everything will change. Oh, my goodness. Help me to talk in here, Pastor. Come on, God, help me. Here it is. They are still lepers at the end of the story. They don't get clean. They don't get changed. The Bible says they're still lepers. But here it is. They're not changed from their skin position, but their living conditions have changed. What are you saying, Pastor? God may force some of us to live with certain conditions, but it don't mean our situation won't change. Some of us are living with things, but we're trusting God through the trial. See, what I've learned is to be great ain't to be perfect. It means to be better than what you used to be. They are still lepers, but they're lepers with gold. Oh, God. They're still lepers, but they're lepers with silver. They're still lepers, but they're lepers driving Bentleys. They're still lepers, but they're lepers eating at Ruth's Chris. See, they're still lepers, but they're lepers wearing Gucci and Prada. See, here is what I found out. Just because you might be a leper doesn't mean God won't change your living condition. Look at it. The king is listening to them because they got money now. The king is listening to them because they got the favor of God. See, you may not change. You may be the same Susie in the cubicle, but when the favor of God is on your life, he will have the supervisor come to your cubicle and listen to you. Why? Because when God favors you, everybody sees the favor on you and want to listen to you. The question is, can you handle blessing them when they didn't want to bless you? The lepers saved the city because they were humble and they wanted to see somebody else blessed. Come on, write this down. I'm done. To be great ain't to be perfect. It means you're better than you used to be. I know that's not good grammar, but it's good gospel. To be great is not to be perfect. Is that better for you? But to be great is to be better than you used to be. But Pastor, I'm still divorced. Yeah, but you're divorced with a peace of mind. But Pastor, I'm still a single mom. Yeah, you're a single mom, but you ain't got drama. Y'all getting along for your child or your children's sake. But Pastor, I'm still unemployed. Yes, but your bills are still getting paid. You still have a surplus. Well, what are you saying? Learn how to appreciate how God blesses you in the midst of where you are. The question is this: can you handle being blessed? Can God trust you with riches that you're not going to just take care of yours, but you're going to bless somebody else? And the true test is, can you help the people that did not help you? Can you help the people that wished you harm? Can you help the people that wished pain on you? Can you help the people that said you'd never make it? Can you help the people that tweeted about you? Can you help the people that put your business out there on social media? Can you pray for those people? That's the true test of your Christianity. And my prayer for us is that we can handle God blessing us because we're going to remain faithful to God. And we're going to trust Him when we can't trace Him. Come on, I want to pray even now. Father, thank you for this opportunity that you've allotted us, that your word has taken root in our hearts. Bless our time, God. Father, we're saying now, help us change our mindset, our perspective, so that we're more humble when you bless us. Help us to be able to bless those that didn't bless us when they were in the position. Help us to be able to help those that are in need, God. Even if they overlooked us when they were in the position, help us to be able to see the need and meet the need. Father, we want to be like you. And the only way for us to do that is to have a heart to want to serve people. A heart like these lepers. Even when the king kicked them out, they said, we want to go and tell the king, we want to save the city. We don't just want to be blessed, but we want to help those that did not help us. Father, I thank you because your word is searching us. Your word is touching us in our very bones and in the marrows. Your word is piercing us in those hard areas that we don't want to expose to anybody. God, thank you for helping us to remain humble. Thank you for the blessings that you're sending our way. Keep us humble so that we'll help somebody else. Don't allow us to get the big head and think that we got it all by ourselves. But Father, as you bless us, we want to remain humble. We want to remain holy, but hungry for you to bless us even more. And we're saying today, God, as you bless us, we're going to bless others. As you increase us, we're going to increase others. As you build us, we're going to build others. That's our prayer right now. It's in your Son, Jesus the Christ's name we pray. Amen. Amen. Listen, I love you all. Oh, it is my prayer that you can handle being blessed. You can handle it. You can handle it. I'm telling you, you can handle it. I don't care what they did. You can handle it. You're built differently because the greater one is on the inside of you. And when God bless you this time, you're going to help everybody regardless of what they said to you or about you. You understand God is watching me. And if he could bless me, I can do the same for somebody else. Did y'all
act like you can't tell who made this new gospel? Homie, take six and take this, haters.
That don't kill me, can only make me stronger. I need you to hurry up now, cause I can't wait much longer. I know I got to be right now, cause I can't get much longer. Man, I've been waiting all night now, that's how long I've been on ya.
Me like it. Right now. I don't know if you.